Okay, so part one is to describe core architectural components of Azure. So let's start off by talking about Azure data centers. So what is an Azure data center? So as you can see on the map here, on the global map, the dots are basically some of the Azure data centers that are all around the world. So you can see there's currently over 60 data centers around the world. And I'm pretty sure by the time this is kind of in a few years' time, at least there'll be data centers probably in every country in the world. That's the kind of the goal. So an Azure data center is a physical, unique physical buildings located all over the globe. And these buildings house a group of network compute servers. So if you think of going into a massive building, there's basically rows and rows and rows of racks and servers, basically all separated with their own power, their own cooling, things like that. And basically these data centers are enormous. You used to be able to get data center tours, but unfortunately that's not a thing anymore. These large data centers are all over the world. They have to be operational 24/7, 365 days a year, every year. So they're basically, they can't ever be down. So the people who work in these Azure data centers have to look after things like power, cooling, the networking, and also cybersecurity to make them basically secure as possible. And the design of these Azure data centers is quite interesting. If you think of the data center in North Europe, which was not in Dublin, that was like a it was like a phase one data center, and they're now on like phase nine. So as time goes past, these data centers have to be, they have to be costless, they have to use less power and less energy, they have to be more sustainable. So going forward, all of these data centers are different. There's not like the same data center as a blueprint in one country as it is in different countries. So like the data center in Dublin is completely different to the data center in Amsterdam, and the one in Amsterdam will be completely different to the one in Australia, for example. So they're all different and they're all new generations. So as time goes past, there are more and more generations. And these facilities need to withstand things like natural disasters, just in case that if there was a natural disaster in let's just say in Australia, for example, these data centers need to be resilient, and you need to have failover and things like that. So they have to be capable to put up with potential disruptions and have backup generators and redundant power and cooling, just in case there are any kind of natural disasters, God forbid. So moving on, this is pictures of what inside a data center looks like. So you can see these three pictures on the screen here. So there's thousands of servers, there's storage devices, there's networking equipment. And this is all to provide the computing resources that us as Azure users use. So I just wanted to show you what it looks like. So each of these server racks have independent power, independent cooling, and independent networking. And they've also got failover in case any of this goes down. So these data centers are designed to be highly scalable, meaning that Microsoft can easily add more resources as needed. So when you see these new data centers come on board, like in Austria is about to come on board, once that starts up, it will start off quite slowly. And as demand comes along, the resources will be scaled to kind of scale out and take care of the demand. So I just wanted to share this link really quickly. So we'll send these slides out at the end, but this is an amazing website link that will show you things like, it gives you an in-depth look at the global operations of Azure. It shows you things like the paired regions, and it'll talk about Azure reliability. It shows you all the different kinds of data centers, past and future, kind of what's coming, what's new, and all that kind of stuff. And it's an amazing resource. And one other resource I wanted to show you is the Azure Data Center. You can actually do a tour. So you can click on this interactive map at this website link on this slide, and you can see what is inside an Azure Data Center. You can like enter the lobby and see what the security is. You can see what the lighting, the solar energy, the wind farms, all that kind of good stuff about all the different types of data centers all around the world. So we'll share these slides at the end, and you can, as a student, you can go and look at and read up on this. So let's talk about the Azure physical infrastructure. So what is an Azure region? So these are physical locations around the world that host your Azure cloud services. So in the UK, for example, we have UK South and UK West, and we also have the Europe, North Europe, I always get that wrong. So an Azure region is basically a set of data centers deployed together and connected through dedicated global networks. So with these global regions, you also have a thing called region pairs. So what is a region pair? The concept is that you have a pair of regions, and in our case, we use West Europe, which is in Amsterdam, and that is paired with the one in Dublin, which is North Europe. And the reason behind that is it allows you to have disaster recovery. So if, for example, you deploy your resources to West Europe, which is Amsterdam, and there is a natural disaster in Amsterdam, all of your resources can disaster recovery fail over, into Dublin. So that's the kind of idea of that. There are a list of region pairs around the world. So if you're in like West US, you can have a region pair in East US, for example, just in case there's something happens on the East Coast of America, you can fail over your resources to East US. The idea going forward is, I think they're going to get rid of these region pairs, and you will be able to disaster recovery over to any region in the world. But that they're kind of working on that in the background. So this is what the Azure region looks like. So you have three availability zones, which is typical. You have zone one, zone two, and zone three. And I tend to think of that as three different actual physical buildings. They have their own power, they have their own cooling, and they have their own networking. And here you would disaster recover over to a different region. So the zone one, two, and three could be West Europe in this case, and you would disaster recover over to North Europe, for example. And that's the idea behind region pairs. Lastly, we talk about sovereign regions. So these are Azure regions designed to comply with specific government regulations or requirements. So there are two at the moment. There's the Azure government, which is things like Azure, basically the US government. So the US government use Azure itself, but it has its own kind of Azure, what's the best way of putting it? Its own type of services that are obviously probably a lot more secure than what you would normally use in public cloud. It's operated by US citizens and offers specific compliance. And there's a list of all of this compliance that you can go and read on the website that we showed earlier. You also have Azure China. And this is a separate instance of Azure specifically designed to meet the regulatory compliance of customers in China. And this is also run by a local partner, which is called 21 VNet. So that's basically what a sovereign region is. There are two at the moment. I'm not sure if there's going to be any more going forward. But that's kind of, you need to know about sovereign regions. You need to know about the availability zones, the region pairs, and the Azure regions for the exam. So that's what these are. And the last one that we want to talk about is availability zones. So availability zones are distinct and isolated locations within the cloud computing region that are designed to provide fault tolerance. So you've got an availability zone one, zone two, and zone three. And in simple terms, what does that mean? It's a physical data center located within the region that is equipped with redundant power as before, and it's fault tolerant. So if you deploy your web app to zone one, you can get it to, and it's, let's say it's in a server rack that fails, you can have that copied over to zone two or zone three as well. So that's the idea of availability zones. They're typically used with all different types of cloud providers. So Amazon have them, Google have them, and Azure has them as well. So it's quite a common thing, an availability zone. So you can connect it to two other zones within the same region through the high bandwidth network links. Okay, so that is that. Let me just see.
I think we have one question in the chat still. Yep. Do Microsoft allow co-hosting your own servers in their data centers?
That is a very good question. I don't actually know the answer to that. I'm assuming, does anyone know? Matt, Simon, do you know the answer to that?
The answer is no. So Azure is a public cloud. There's no co-location kind of capability within Azure. You know, so if you can't rock it with your own servers and ask Microsoft to like host them for you, it's just,
no.
If you want to run a virtual machine, you're running it on their hardware.
Yeah, you can get them to send out a data box. So if you were, if you did have lots of data that you wanted to put into Azure, you can ask them to send you a data box, and then you would transfer the data onto that, and then they would ship that back to the data center and do that for you. But that's the only thing that I think you could do that with.
I mean, with Azure Arc and stuff, you can also, but then you have your infrastructure more locally, right?
So, yes, yes, yeah. Yes. We covered Azure Arc later on as well. I don't think that's this part. I think that's the third part. So Azure Arc allows you to extend your on-premise servers into Azure so that you can basically go into the Azure portal and look at your servers as if they were already servers in Azure. So there is that. You could potentially do that. For example, you could have SQL Server on-prem in your office and connect that into Azure using Azure Arc, and you would see it in the list of SQL Servers right next to the Azure SQL Servers. So there is potential for that as well. But we do cover that in the last, I think we do cover that in the last part.